So today's topic is oxygen inhalation. So we'll start with oxygen therapy. Why do we need to give oxygen therapy? There are some basic terms you need to know. First is oxygen. Oxygen is a colorless, odorless, tasteless gas that is essential for the body to function properly and to survive. As we all know, we all need oxygen to survive. Then what is oxygen therapy and why we give oxygen therapy? Oxygen therapy is the administration of oxygen at a concentration of pressure greater than that found in the environmental atmosphere. The air that we breathe contain approximately 21% of oxygen, okay? Then what is oxygen therapy? It is a key treatment in respiratory care or patient with respiratory disease or problem. What are the purposes? It is given. The body is constantly taking in oxygen and releasing carbon dioxide. It is a normal process. Okay. If the process is inadequate, oxygen levels in the blood decrease and the patient may need supplemental oxygen. If we are not able to take oxygen from the environment, then we have to supplement the oxygen. The purpose is to increase oxygen saturation in tissue where the saturation levels are too low due to illness or any kind of injury. There are some indications in these conditions we should or we have to provide oxygen supplement. Acute respiratory failure, acute myocardial infarction, cardiac failure, shock, hypermetabolic state induced by trauma, burns or any sepsis, anemia, cyanide poisoning during CPR and during anesthesia for surgery. Then oxygen is a kind of prescribed drug. Okay, it must be written legally by the doctor. Prescription should be dated by the doctor. And doctor must indicate duration of oxygen therapy, that is how much long you have to give oxygen therapy to the patient. Okay, the oxygen concentration must be prescribed, the flow rate must be prescribed. Is it 2 liter, 4 liter, 6 liter, 10 liter, 15 liter? It should be written on prescription. Then sources of oxygen, oxygen cylinder and oxygen valve outlets are sources for oxygenation. This is oxygen cylinder. First, using oxygen cylinder. Oxygen cylinder is delivered with protective cap to prevent accidental force against the cylinder outlet. So that to prevent leakage of oxygen, to release oxygen safely at a desirable rate, and a regulator is used. When and how much amount you need, you have to just set the regulator, and that amount only you will be delivered to the patient. A reduction gauge is there that shows the amount of oxygen in the tank. A flow meter that regulates the control of oxygen in liters per minute. Oxygen is moistened by passing it through a humidifier to prevent the mucous membrane of the respiratory tree from becoming dry. This is a flow meter, humidifying chamber, flow adjuster is there, pressure gauge, screw cap, pressure reducing valve, safety valve, all these things are present here. You can see oxygen key. Then valve outlet of the oxygen. Oxygen is supplied from a central source through a pipeline. Only a flow meter and a humidifier are required to supply oxygen. this is a wall outlet, you can see it. Then methods of oxygen administration. These are the oxygen delivery systems: nasal cannula, simple mask, partial rebreather mask, non-rebreather mask, venturi mask, oxygen hood, oxygen tent, ambubag, tracheostomy collar, TPs. By all these methods, you can provide oxygen at different concentration level. In methods of oxygen administration, first is nasal cannula. We also called it nasal prongs. It is a disposable plastic device with two protruding prongs. As you can see in this, there are two protruding prongs for insertion into the nostrils. It is connected to the oxygen source. It is used for low medium concentration of oxygen, that is 24% to 44%. You can see a person is wearing nasal prong here. Then this is the amount to deliver nasal from via nasal cannula. You can deliver 24% to 44% of oxygen, or in liters you can administer 1 to 6 liters per minute. Advantages of nasal cannula: client will be able to talk and eat with oxygen in place because it doesn't cover the patient's mouth. Easily used in home settings, and it is a safe and simple method and easily tolerated. Delivers low concentration of oxygen. What are the disadvantages? Unable to use with nasal obstruction. If there is any kind of nasal obstruction surgery or anything that is obstructing nasal area, then you cannot prescribe this method. Drying to mucous membrane, so flow greater than 4 liter per minute needs to be humidified. As we all know, when we are providing oxygen to the patient, it should be humidified. If you are giving at the rate of 2 liter or 1 liter, it should be humidified. So, and can dislodge from nerves easily. Cause skin irritation or breakdown over ears or at the nerves. As we it pipeline touches the ears and nose, so it can just break down the skin there. So we have to look for that. It is disadvantage of this nasal cannula. Not good for mouth breathers. Patient's breathing pattern affects exact FiO2. Then nursing intervention for nasal cannula. Be alert for skin breakdown over the ears and in the nostrils for too tight an application. Ask the patient, is it too tight or too loose? Okay. Then observe for mucus dryness. Check frequently that both prongs are in nares. Then there is second is face mask. Face mask is simple oxygen mask, partial rebreather mask, non-rebreather mask, and venturi mask. First of all, we will deal with simple oxygen mask. It is made of clear, flexible plastic or rubber that can be molded to fit the face. It is held to the head with elastic bands. There will be an elastic band to hold the mask. Some have metal clip that can be bent over the bridge of the nose for the comfortable fit. There is a metal substance over the nasal area. We can press it and bend it so that it can stay over the nose. The simple oxygen mask advantages: it can provide increased delivery of oxygen for a short period of time. It is used for a big amount of oxygen. Then disadvantages. It is tight sealed, required to deliver higher concentration. Because it is tight sealed, it will cause discomfort to the patient. Difficult to keep mask in position over nose and mouth. Potential for skin breakdown. As we all know, it will be there for hours. So it can cause pressure and moisture and cause skin breakdown. Uncomfortable for patient while eating or talking. And expensive than nasal tube or nasal prong. Nursing interventions for oxygen mask. Monitor the client frequently to check the placement of the mask. If you are providing via any means, if you are providing oxygen via any means, you have to check on the patient or assist the patient timely. Secure physician's order to replace the mask with nasal cannula during mealtime. If there is mealtime, you have to just see the order that we can replace the oxygen mask or not with nasal cannula at that time. Then partial rebreather mask. The mask is with a reservoir bag that must remain inflated during both inspiration and expiration. It collects of the part of the patient's exhaled air. That is why it is called partial rebreather mask, because you intake your carbon dioxide in this, that is exhaled air. It is used to deliver oxygen concentrations up to 80%. It is not 100% oxygen, it is 80% oxygen and some of your exhaled air amount. The oxygen flow rate must be maintained at a minimum of 6 liter per minute to ensure that the patient does not rebreathe large amount of exhaled air. The remaining exhaled air exits through vents. There are two vents over the mask. By these vents, your carbon dioxide can release the remaining carbon dioxide. Then advantages: clients can inhale room air through opening in the mask if oxygen supply is briefly interrupted. Disadvantage: required tight seal, eating and talking difficult and uncomfortable. Nursing intervention: set flow rate so mask remains 2/3 full during inspiration. Keep reservoir bag free of piss or kinks so that the oxygen flow will not be obstructed. This mask provides the highest concentration of oxygen, that is 95% to 100%, and the flow rate is 15 liter per minute. Non-rebreather mask is similar to the partial rebreather mask, except two one-way valves prevent conservation of exhaled air. In this, as we know, in partial rebreather mask, you can intake exhaled air, some amount of exhaled air, but in this, you can't take your exhaled air part. The bag has an oxygen reservoir. When the patient exhales air, the one-way valve closes and all of the expired air is deposited into the atmosphere, not in the reservoir bag. In partial rebreather mask, there is some amount of exhaled air that is deposited in the reservoir bag, but in this non-rebreather mask, there is oxygen, pure oxygen in the reservoir bag. In this way, the patient is not rebreathing any of the expired gas. This is the picture of non-rebreather mask. Advantages of non-rebreather mask: deliver the highest possible oxygen concentration, suitable for patient breathing spontaneous with severe hypoxemia. nursing interventions for non-rebreather mask. A patient is having non-rebreather mask. Maintain flow rate so reservoir bag collapse only slightly during inspiration. Check that valves and rubber flaps are functioning properly. Monitor saturation of oxygen with pulse oximeter. Next is Venturi mask. It is used to provide high flow of oxygen, that is 40 to 50%, and in liters 4 to 15 liters per minute. The mask is constructed so that there is a constant flow of room air blended with a fixed concentration of oxygen. This is the picture of Venturi mask. There are adapters of different color with different flow rates according to the flow rates. It is designed with wide bore tubing and various color coded jet adapters. Each color code corresponds to a precise oxygen concentration and a specific liter flow. It is used with mainly used with COPD patients. Advantages of Venturi mask: it delivers most precise oxygen concentration, doesn't dry mucous membrane. And disadvantage: uncomfortable for the patient, risk for skin irritation, and produce respiratory depress in COPD patient with high oxygen concentration up to 50%. Because COPD patient cannot take, because of their lungs collapse or in injured condition, so they are not able to take excess amount of oxygen. Then priority nursing intervention. Requires careful monitoring to verify FiO2 at flow rate order. Check that air intake valves are not blocked. Next is oxygen hood. This method is used for babies who can breathe on their own but still need extra oxygen. A hood is a plastic dome or box with a warm, moist oxygen inside. It just covers the head of the baby. The hood is placed over the baby's head. Like this. This is the hood that covers the baby's head. Then oxygen tent. Oxygen tent consists of a canopy placed over the head and the shoulders, or over the entire body of a patient to provide oxygen at a higher level than normal. It is typically, the tent is made of see-through plastic material so that we can monitor the patient. It can envelop the patient's bed with the end sections held in place by mattress to ensure that the tent is airtight. The tent should be airtight so that no leakage of oxygen take place. The enclosure often has a side opening with a zipper. There is a zipper or zip thing from which we can open it and close it. Like this. This is the oxygen tent covering the patient's whole body, and we can see through the patient here. Now Embu bag. It is artificial manual breathing unit or bag valve mask ventilation. It is a handheld device. We can hold this device into the hand. Commonly used to provide positive pressure ventilation to the patient who are not breathing or not breathing adequately. This is the ample bag with a reservoir. Reservoir bag is connected downwards to the ambu bag, and there is face mask and tubing also there. Then tracheostomy collar or mask. It is inserted directly into the trachea. Is indicated for the chronic oxygen therapy need. And oxygen flow rate is about 8 to 10 liter. It provides accurate FiO2, provides good humidity and comfortable and more efficient to the patient. This is the tracheostomy collar. TPs. It is used on end of ET tube when the weaning from when we are weaning patient from ET tube from ventilator. Provides accurate FiO2 and provides good humidity. This is TPs. Then side effects and complication of oxygen therapy. There are major three complications of oxygen therapy. Oxygen toxicity, retrolental, fibroplasia, absorption, atelectasis. What is oxygen toxicity? It is a condition which occurs due to inspiration of higher concentration of oxygen for a prolonged period of time. If you are giving continuous oxygen to the patient without any prescription or without any looking to the patient, without any assessment, it can cause oxygen toxicity to the patient. Oxygen concentration greater than 50% over 24 to 48 hours can cause pathological changes in the lungs and can harm the patient very badly. These are the side effects. First side effect is retrolental fibroplasia, blindness due to vasoconstriction and ischemia. How vasoconstriction take place? There is abnormal proliferation of fibrous tissue behind the lens of the eye, and that leads to blindness. These fibrous tissue abnormal growth cause vasoconstriction and ischemia and cause blindness. Then absorption atelectasis. During 100% oxygen delivery, nitrogen in alveoli is washed out and replaced by oxygen. In contrast to nitrogen, oxygen is extremely soluble in the blood and diffuse very quickly into the pulmonary vasculature, so that not enough gas is left in the alveoli to maintain the patency. We need gas to maintain the patency of the alveoli, and the alveoli collapses. This is known as absorption atelectasis. Nitrogen is mainly used to maintain the patency because it stays for a long time there. Safety precautions. Oxygen is highly combustible gas, as we all know. So we should put a board near patient, no smoking board or no ignition board. Although it does not burn spontaneously or cause an explosion, it can easily cause fire in a patient's room if it contacts a spark from an open flame or electrical equipment. Oxygen is a therapeutic gas and it must be prescribed and adjust only with a healthcare provider's order. When you are providing, you should just look into the orders, physician order. place an oxygen in use, sign on the patient's door in the patient's room. As I have told you, put a board over there where you are providing oxygen. No smoking board or whatever board is available in the hospital. If using oxygen at home, place a sign on the door of the house. No smoking should be allowed on the premises. Keep oxygen delivery system 10 feet from any open flames. Determine that electrical equipment in the room is functioning correctly. When using oxygen cylinders, secure them so they do not fall over. Store them upright and either chained or secured in appropriate holders so that leakage of oxygen does not take place. Check the oxygen level of portable tanks before transporting a patient to ensure that there is enough oxygen in the tank. So there is a procedure. How will you administer the oxygen? Techniques of oxygen administration. First of all, assess the patient's condition. You have to look into all these things while assessment. Then plan. There is a rationale for each and everything. These are the steps of oxygen administration. Just go through them. Then after providing oxygenation, you should evaluate the patient. Breathing pattern is normal or not. Check for the nails, lips and nail beds. Conjunctiva of the eyes is pink or red in color, or bluish coloration is there. Bluish discoloration indicates cyanosis. A patient is in no confusion, disorientation, difficulty with cognition is there or not. Check for the arterial oxygen concentration or hemoglobin level. Oxygen saturation within normal limits or not. Then document the procedure with date and time oxygen started, method of delivering oxygenation, oxygen concentration and flow rate of the oxygen. If you are giving 2 liter per minute, 3 liter per minute, 4 liter per minute, whatever it is, just mention it in nursing notes. Patient's observation, how was the patient looking? Add oronasal care to the nursing care plan. Thank you so much.